everybody. My name is Scott Watson. I'm the director of Belkin Art Gallery. And I'd like to welcome you to this afternoon's talk by the artists who produced this exhibition, Julia Feyrer and Tamara Henderson. Julia and Tamara both have independent practices. In fact, we have work by Julia in our collection. But for the past several years, they've worked collaboratively on this project. Let me just say a bit about it and how it came to be here. They'll talk a lot more about it, of course. But considering the velvet here is a gallery installation, it's also a film set. I knew about it, but I was really kind of drawn to it and wondering if we could do it when my friend Jesse McKee insisted I go visit Tamara. And Tamara graciously spent an hour with me explaining what the project looked like through slides on her computer when it was at the ICA in Philadelphia, which was its second iteration. Its first iteration was at Banff, where Jesse had curated a show called Considering the Belvedere, containing some of the components of the exhibition that's here. So basically, we asked Tamara and Julia if they would consider doing a third version, and a year's work, and many back and forth later, and a very intense installation period, here it is. I'd like to say that, you know, working with them, but watching them work, I'm so impressed by the process. It's imagination, it's generativeness, it's intuitiveness, to the point of even working blind, even literally blindfolded, strikes me as something that's very generous to the world in times that are otherwise a little dark and troubled. It's a beautiful practice. I was first drawn to it for maybe side reasons. I was drawn to it because of the idea of turning the Belvedere building into a bar. The Belvedere is a building at 12th and Main. I think it's an early 20th century building. It's an apartment building, and it houses a lot of artists and people working in studios. And it's the kind of living structure that's disappearing in Vancouver. And it's a precious thing. And it's not only what it is, but it's a whole way of life. And I was drawn to it because I'm really concerned with these issues. So I see it as this show in a funny kind of way as a pendant to the Tom Burrow show we did last year, which also had a lot to do with ways of habitation and living in Vancouver, which is in crisis as we know it. So that's my introduction. So without further ado, please welcome Julia and Tamara.
Kind of bring everything back into a frame to kind of understand the work if you haven't seen them in their entirety. I guess you should we're not going to show them right now.
We'll start here, but we will maybe turn the films back on after the gallery tour, and so they're in they're spliced together, and the titles are Bottles Under the Influence, which is a film that we made in 2009. We started to make that film in Stockholm, in Sweden. And then we made Bottles Influence, and then we made Consider the Belvedere last year. So those are the two films we've made so far in this film set that we've had in Philadelphia, Consider the Belvedere. We filmed, and we will film this one and pair them up to be The Last Waves, which is a third in a trilogy so far as we work.
So the installation in the other galleries is a film set, and but hasn't yet being activated as one, so it's kind of like setting up this imaginary film, which doesn't exist yet. But
and you will find all most there are many objects and almost actors in here, extras in there. So it's interesting to take the time after to watch and then look closely at the objects in there and then
piece them together.
Because it's a it's a bit of an archival show too. Also, we have toured these things since we started working on Bottles Under the Influence.
Let's move into the first space with the bar. And so this is our version of the Belvedere. It's a like court. It's actually called the Belvedere Courts. So it's like a court-shaped building, but it also, in this version, is a bar. And the full title, I think, is Nighttime's Press Bar for Dream Journalists. So that gives you an idea of what the keyboards are for. We are collecting people's dreams. Dreams remembered from your sleep, not aspirations, although I guess the question is like, what is a dream and how to interpret it, how to remember it, how to record it, how to transform it into language. And so this is a kind of broadcast of that question. If you look below here, there's a window down there, which is kind of the main frame of the whole operation, and it links all the keyboards together, and it's kind of visibly connecting, presenting the inner workings of this program that was designed by Dan Riley.
And it's also important to take a look around the rooms. We've set this building up with 52 rooms and one less story than it has in real, right? It has one more story. So here it's kind of ghosted. But each room, not each one, some are not home or they have their blinds shut and some have full interiors.
So each room, it's kind of telling a different little story.
We could introduce Brian. We worked with Brian Ditchburn, the chemistry glass blowing department here on UBC on a piece for the laboratory, but right below Jesse, in front of Jesse and Vivian, there's a room dedicated to the glass blower. So you find the communicating vessels that Julia found in a sale, a chemistry sale. That was the original little model, the way we communicated to him what we wanted to build, which is in the laboratory. And then he gave us a magazine called The Flow, and we were quite fascinated by his ability to heal glass, as we were both readers of Philip K. Dick, and he had written a book, Galactic Pot Healer. And Julia said one day, he's just like the pot healer in Philip K. Dick's novel. And so there already spirals a character or relationship within our work. And so most every room here has that sort of, it had been generated and then it had been placed. So yeah, do take a look around. And if you have any questions about certain rooms or details or so on, you could also.
What's the Philip K. Dick story?
Galactic Pot Healer.
The main character's called to another, I forget the planet's name, but his ability is to heal pots, so he can take a shard of ceramic and he knows it's past life, so he reforms it. And Brian has piles of broken chemistry glass and he heals them. And he's done that on a part of our communicating vessels as well, healed the glass. Rather than making a new one or so. And that book is highly recommended. He did receive a copy, Julia.
Can I ask, if you have glass in a lot of glass in your films, and I'm wondering why you're doing it?
Well, it's, I guess it just goes back to the original film, which we shot in Stockholm at the Museum of Wine and Spirits, which was a museum that kind of chronicled the history of alcohol in Sweden through dioramas. But this museum doesn't really exist in its form that we filmed it. But we did a lot of research in their archives, and we collected our own bottle collection, and then we began to interact with that collection by placing it into the museum's collection, superimposing it on the museum's collection, putting it into a glass kiln, melting it, transforming it, and then the final scene is that we hired a sharpshooter to shoot the bottles and explode them and their contents. But I mean, glass is just also one material among many, and it's kind of, you know, we like it for its alchemical possibilities, I suppose, but it also leads us into many different other materials as well.
We've kind of journeyed through certain methodologies or processes in Bottles Under the Influence with changing the set and setting for the bottle, like putting it into a kiln, introducing it to high temperatures, and this was from our collection. So we began really making a collection of bottles, with Bottles Under the Influence, and then sleeping with them, putting them to sleep, filling them, combusting them. So we develop a relationship through those methods, and then have a data bank of methods in our collaboration through glass. So I think it's also a binder between us in our interest, our mutual interest in the vessel, and then communicating vessels.
But also there's something, because the characters throughout all of the stories are all vessels themselves. So you kind of imbue them with personalities. And most of the characters are made of glass as well.
Right. They begin, most of them, they did begin in clay.
Right. Could you set up the characters for us? Can you?
We should maybe go into the lab. I don't know. We can skip ahead, but it would be easier to introduce the characters if they were
in front of us.
You
feel now is the time to do it.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, we can circle back too and get to waves later.
So basically, the characters that we're referring to here are in many different states in this room. They're finished here in a glass vessel form. They're connected in a communicating vessels. And each arm of this base table stems out to reveal their making and their almost, well, they each begin with a their mechanism, so the paper brick maker, which made the newspapers, bricks for the bar, the newspaper offset plates, the bottles becoming really itself. This is something we use in the mold making process. The clear form first, the colored form, the newspaper bottle becoming the boiler room bottle, and then back again to the paper maker that we used when we made the floor at Wade's Cafe. And so, the pest detective.
This is the pest detective model. He's also on every page of the Yellow Pages in Vancouver. So he's a notorious character. And if you look closely at the original drawing, he is actually a insect in detective's clothes. So it's kind of like this idea of in order to like solve the crime, you have to like, you have, you are the insect, you are the suspect.
The pest.
You are the pest.
Is that romantic?
Maybe. Yeah.
When the narrator realizes he's a character in the story.
I think it could be a good example of that.
Are dreams represented in this as well as in the first installation?
It's a slippery question. I don't know. I mean, not literally, but
it's like, am dreams. I ever sleeping? Or no, am I ever awake kind of question.
Yeah.
This sort of work, I think it becomes finally communicated or... So we mostly when we went out with Straight Dream Record, we did produce Night Times with our own dreams, the newspaper, and this is the newspaper table. So down there on the legs, there are the offset plates that we use to print the paper, and then consider the Belvedere. You do see the paper being printed, so it has roots. That spread all over the place. So if they're represented there, for sure. I mean embodied, but maybe not direct recall in each object or something like that.
Sure. It looked like the entire paper was redacted at one point. It appeared as if all the text had been obliterated.
Yeah, that was the beauty of collaborating with that newspaper. We went there, where were we and what was it called?
It's a web press in Park Hill. Oh, I can't remember.
They invited us to go in and go through the process. And so we could, with the timing mechanism of the Bolex, which we shoot on, we could time it with the operator of the ink table control or panel. And he could flood it back again and bring it to clarity and, you know, balance it out quite quickly. Because they can at the newspaper do that, right?
Where was this?
It was like magic.
In Port Coquitlam. Yeah, to the point where everything was just covered in this black ink and, like, it got on the camera. And then subsequently, when we were filming with the camera, we would have, like, black smudges all over ourselves. Because it's like... It just like gets on everything.
It's a messy business. Making newspapers.
So this is all, not that, is all one work.
The last waves is the...
No, but these tables are one work.
They, yeah, yes. The laboratory is a work. So again, each table is stemming from or leading up to the final form.
That's not part of it, that's something else.
That's the rotating Kukulorus. rotating door, revolving door.
They do relate. I mean, everything relates to each other.
There's a language that you're using that reminds me of Duchamp.
Mm-hmm.
Of things, I can forget the communicating vessels here. And you think of things like the large glass or rice with their bathrooms even, but there's some of the language that is that ever playing?
Well, for the newest blind bottle, which is the one on the end that kind of looks like the squiggling crazy straw, we actually took two pieces of string and dropped them, which are on this table. So that's a Duchampian gesture, and then the drawing is here. And he just traced that line, and also with the hot glass, so it actually like burnt through the paper.
And then this would be the chance. This table is the chance table.
Yeah.
So on this table, you have drawings from when we designed the chance bottle. In the Stockholm Museum of Wine and Spirits, we found a drawing that was describing this, the method with not a graph system like numbers to arrive at symmetry. And so we apply this rolling of the die to that graph system. And then if you take a look to the drawings, the numbers that we roll on this side, and then the bottle still follows the symmetry. And then the second bottle, we made the chance bottle. And we made this for magnets. And then we dragged it along Kitsilano Beach with sunset on a rope. And then it collected from the beach this material and that coin, which was the date that we made it. So it was quite a beautiful exercise.
And these drawings are like the illustration of how we made this rough geometric profile of the bottle. We played this game where we rolled dice and kind of mapped out different points on the graph paper and then connected them together. So that kind of resulted in this form, which has the dice in the bottle. And as a mixture, each bottle has a different alcohol. So the newspaper bottle has a smoked whiskey, which we collaborated with two artists from Everything Co. to make. They distilled it for us. And the pest detective has a apple wine, like a Hessisch apple wine, which is a Frankfurt, a very popular Frankfurt beverage, which I have made myself in the past.
We met in Frankfurt.
Yeah.
So Hessen and apple wine, and we have the communicating vessels fountain that is a Bembel from this drinking establishment, the Apple Vine Bar. And that was also something we hadn't mentioned, where we kind of met at school in Frankfurt. Or why Frankfurt? School.
Yep. And then the old hag, she has a valerian tincture, which is kind of a sleeping, dream-inducing herb. And the blind bottle, which we also collaborated with Everything Co. to make us a moonshine, but the kind of part of the moonshine that you're supposed to throw away, which is can be quite poisonous and has the reputation of turning people blind if consumed in large quantities.
Mm-hmm.
And then the chance bottle has a mixture of all the alcohols together, randomly. So it's
swamp
like a
water.
Swamp water.
And the one thing about the comment with the blindfolded work is, and to, as we ended on the blind bottle, this is a blind table. So this was an exercise that we made here in the gallery with clay and sculpting blindfolded with math. And that's how we made the blind bottle always, to sit together with a piece of clay, blindfolded and sculpt, and then cast that form in in plaster, then glass blowing. And in this case, we sculpted the form blindfolded. We took the molds, and we attended a couple of 3D movies at the cinema, and in the garbage, we found so many wasted glasses. So we melted them down and pushed them into the mold. So we remembered the form in that mold, and there it is. So it's also the blind bottle. And
there's like this dense accumulation of everything, even just the stories, and it just made me wonder, actually, even how do you keep track? Like, is there like writings or like journals or something where you can keep track to even like build from one to the next?
Yeah. I don't know. I see this room is because it's an accumulation of a lot of stages and quite evolutionary, especially here with the secretary as she steps through that gateway of her own head. Like, this is her typing mechanism, the stenograph. And she's clay, she's being covered with silicone, and then the mold, our attempts at making the bottle ourselves hollow. So we have this mini hand inside of the walking hand, and then to the form, and some other things, her coat and what she wears, the cacti pads. We use cochineal with this one. So it is a bit of a little autobiography for both with us and the character. But I think here in this room, it like keeps it quite under wraps, or it lets them breathe or something. It's like they're breathing, and then that's what they have to say, or so far in their existence. Or whatever.
Yeah, there's space for all the steps.
Yeah, so I guess in keeping track, we just like, you know, like you have these stems, and then they grow. So it's really like an organic kind of process.
How did you come to the figure of a secretary, or the secretary?
Through past detective, firstly, I think.
Yeah, there was this, all these backstories of the characters kind of that aren't visible. The films are kind of playing with narrative but never making it explicit, so. But the past detective, of course, has a secretary, I don't know, and,
and she was living in 309 because Julie lives in the Belvedere, and the doors of the Belvedere, they feel like a detective setting, like a setting, because like the door, the glass is, yeah, I think your glass is yellow, isn't it?
Yeah, all the doors have this different glass window. It's kind of unusual. And so I don't know. Naturally, instead of just remaining a secondary character, she emerged as becoming kind of this shape-shifting entity between the old hag and the secretary, in this prop from the film, the six-armed hoodie.
A bug.
She becomes like an insect, and in the same way that this old hag has these six limbs, that's one of the ways you can identify a true bug is that it has six limbs, six arms. So, but then, yeah, the old hag and the secretary have kind of morphed back into each other and out of each other and kind of blur a little bit.
And they're working in two different like spectrums, because secretary, we should mention now, and luckily we have Vivian in the room, because she made concocted an energy drink now for the secretary, which some of you might have tried at the opening. So energy and old hag is towards more the night and a deep, deep, deep place. And so I think they're working these like also high energy six arms seem, and there's even a multitasking image in one of these Canadian secretary pages, which is a journal that we have used to decorate or her nest, or her like busy office set, which you see and consider the Belvedere. But we should talk a bit about the energy drink. It was really an interesting process to go through, and an interesting topic, because we were trying to find like or have a question in our heads, like what it will be an energy drink or an energy inducer, because also when we were working on this exhibition, we were commuting, and then we were always like, active all day and like taking electrolytes, trying to like be energetic, and at the same time collaborating with Vivian, making an energy drink. So she knows much more about the ingredients than me. Can you say a few things about the energy drink, Vivian?
So
want to borrow my?
Oh no. So the energy drink relates to the secretary character, and so the cochineal is kind of an important color.
Can you speak up?
Put me on the spot.
So the energy drink was meant to have a relationship with the secretary, and so we were working with the cochineal bug, which is the bug that lives on the cactus, the nopal cactus, and feeds off of it, and it turns this really beautiful color that you can see.
We died. Like, all these things are died with this bug. It's this quite common bug that's used in fabric textile dyeing and also in the food and beverage industry as a food safe color additive.
And there's a little bit grounded up in the coffee filter there on the table if you want to get a peek at the powder or the color, like the way in the little bottle there are the bugs, and then it's been ground to the powder. This red coffee plastic thing.
I had a question.
Yes.
In this whole process for each of you, was anything like the alchemists went through, like alchemy?
Well,
it is.
He's asking about alchemy. I mean, you'd have to ask the alchemist. I don't know.
I think Vivian's process is close because she went through the process of combining. Because here we've visually combined entities and materials and substances to arrive visually somewhere. And when you say alchemy, I think more towards the energy drink, because when we had these conversations around concocting something, or we did spend a lot of time on the vessels in a chemistry lab where there are lab processes that gases change, solids change state, whatever, and they arrive. To me, that seems quite alchemical. And this, to arrive at an energy drink with no sugar. We just to say a little bit more, because we got sidetracked with the cochineal. So starting here, we have this conversation like the cochineal insect, which we had used as a dye for the set, considered the Belvedere, for the apartment of the secretary. And then 1 year later, we're coming back with this secretary bottle, and we've always been on the search for an energy drink. And then how to make something like that. And so we turned to Vivian, and what else did you, we started with that cactus base because that was something that tied it also quite closely to the secretary. And then step two was?
Thinking about like what energy would mean to the secretary character. So there's like adaptogens that can give you energy in a different way than stimulants, but like ideally you have a combination of both in a kind of elixir or tincture. Mm-hmm. And the fruits of the cactus are actually the same color as the cochineal, I guess, for some of the same chemical reasons. And that's where you get the really beautiful color, and that was the juice. We used the juice from the fruit of the cactus in combination with an elixir or tincture with like energy with plants like rhodiola and
things like that. Secret some of the elixir contents because but it's very special. We have Vivian. I have a tincture at home now with this elixir, and that it feels quite alchemical having this like mysterious elixir and then taking it instead of coffee.
What's an adaptogen?
It's a plant that will adapt for whatever stress you're encountering. So stress is complex. We experience all the different kinds of stress, and maybe one form of stress is a kind of low energy feeling. And so an adaptogen is going to adapt based on the stress you're experiencing at the time. That's my interpretation.
You feel transformed by the process yourself? Like an amazing
entity? Always, yeah. Yeah, always. This is the first time that we've brought, it really felt we brought many components of our work together, our time and our language here in these spaces. And then we haven't visited the hotel yet, but that's another site where we have sort of used a strategy or like provided a constraint for ourselves as artists, like in the hotel we've worked with the aura. And so, I think each, of course, exhibition or each work of art is like, and this is our collaboration, so. It's also a retrospective sort of culmination of things, I feel like. Do you feel like you always?
Yeah.
So shall we take a look at the hotel, or do you have questions about this lab while we're standing here with the objects? Any things?
And this picture's the hat.
The hat?
Hag.
Hag.
Oh, the old hag. She's...
This is the bottle.
Yeah, up there.
But she doesn't have a table.
She doesn't have a table.
No, she's mixed in with the secretary.
Yeah. She is here without arms. This was an early version here before the glass blowers put the arms on. And then here, in the clear.
But this bottle is what? I mean, it's there, but it doesn't get to be up there.
Well, that's the thing, that it's they are the same.
They had a mind flip in Philly, like they went like, oh, old hag, secretary,
okay.
And blind, 3D. Chance went to the beach and was made out of magnets, so it was no longer hollow. And newspaper, boiler, and then pest detective went into the futuristic
ultralight
material.
Ultralight Cuban fiber, which is like a fabric.
Nanomaterial.
Yeah, developed by NASA, that's like also used in scaling, professional yacht racing.
And that bottle is hanging on the typewriter. If you see, his body is through the, so it's a soft bottle, like to go. So there were a few to go bottles in Consider the Belvedere. And then for the last waves, we produced this communicating vessels. So each, it does go back to the forms that we mostly came up with in Stockholm in 2009. And so they're a bit solid here, opaque and full, and here kind of like spirits, or they're to me very spectral and skeletal or something like that. And they're connected. But they did, they do have a little jump into another identity, a dualism. And in this case, old hag didn't have so much in her closet. The secretary had a lot, because she just happened last year, and the old hag kind of was a few years ago.
I think we made an old hag monument in Newfoundland, which is an almost 9 foot tall sculpture. And it is that form, the six armed form, and each arm has so much material and it has a different characteristic of each arm, and then its body is like a cavernous container also, so I think a lot of that material got collected in her and is a little bit absent here, but she's
in our
she can't
minds.
Be in more than one place at one time. She's too slow and big.
And she has six arms, like, so even if these were all extensions from like a core, she has like these six personality extensions. So I was explaining yesterday how one of her arms is made from the graveyard of the Atlantic, like stuff that washed up from the ocean in Newfoundland. So it's very dense, and we're going to meet it soon next week, and I can't wait to smell it or something. It will smell so, like, because it did smell pretty heavy, because the graveyard of the Atlantic was quite a gray place.
Is she still there?
She went. Traveled.
She traveled to Stockholm.
The passport was huge. The old flying passport. Shall we take a look in the hotel?
Yeah.
Well, now we're up here. You can feel free to. It's kind of easy to start over here, actually, if you don't mind, with this reception desk, I think. Just because, the beds, they kind of roll out at the end. This table, we could start by looking at it. It's a lot of drawings and plans and writing, so on, from our collection of paperworks. And here at the end of this table, there are the two drawings we made in Philadelphia of our aura readings. So we sat with an aura reader. I don't remember her name. She was great. And she read the aura, like read the colors of the body and dictated them. And then we took notes and took turns and made these paintings based on those descriptions. So first it would have been written in word, and then these two drawings were translated to color filters for underneath the bodies that we had them placed in Philadelphia like that. And so the light came from under the body. The aura was the light illuminating the body bed. And now there are the receptionists. This is our hotel reception and the hotel room.
Your work seems to be really influenced by the location that you're in. You've mentioned Philadelphia. Can you talk about how the work here has been influenced by being at UBC?
Yeah, well,
this table, for example, is designed by one of UBC's architects. Michael
Kingsville.
Michael Kingsville, and it was at the sub-building, like many other things in this exhibition space. In waves, we have the display cases in behind the scenes, underneath the hotel, etc. The tables in the lab, all coming from UBC as they're renovating.
The old student union building.
Yeah.
And so we could do some scouting around, location scouting for objects. and this table was just so perfect. It kind of reminded us of the hook of a question mark. And so we related to it in that way. And then we had our home base at the studio.
We had a studio out here for the summer, so it was an ideal season moment to be out here working, where Brian and the chemistry glassblowing had time to work with us, and these things were just also, the timing was perfect. They were being thrown away anyway, and we also went to the BD.
Yeah, the bug calendar.
And on the wall over there in the case is the bug calendar we discovered in the freezer, which was a collection of bugs that were displayed once a month. They were like the bug of a month in the late 90s.
In the entomology BD section, yeah. The entomologist spent hours showing us around and lending us a few specimens. There's also like a room facing waves in the Belvedere that is like the king suite for the borrowed cockroach, and what else do we have from them? Assassin bug.
And a tropical bed bug, which is
huge.
Disturbingly gigantic.
And so we borrowed the specimens from, and then this seems quite perfect for the hotel. Like it's a calendar of bugs. So you get a sense of time.
What's going to happen to Wolfie?
Ask us later. I don't know.
No, I mean, there are certain things like the aura, the nasal, the five, some of the tables, but things like the bark or the leg.
If only it will be a local newspaper.
hang up.
That's the that would be ideal. If a dream, if the newspaper could just be somewhere, it seems like a great establishment. It was an active bar, so the area where we were standing was the bartender's area, and then the newspaper.
In the Belvedere.
Yeah, the bar. Or no, maybe not in the Belvedere. It's not big enough in there. The rooms are small.
The basement, maybe.
Could be. I think it should be. Yeah, they need a new press bar, I think. The Vancouver Sun or something.
Good, love that.
Now that newspapers are...
I think the press bar has been going downhill or something, so they... We need to revive the 24-hour thing. Mm-hmm. No, I think that would, that's a dream, of course. Like, that the newspaper could function, many people could contribute, and that community would be strong, I think.
But it will be documented in the film.
No, I realized that, so it's just curious because it's so labor-intensive and it's so dreamed or figured out in some way between your mind.
Mm-hmm.
Kind of a virtual space, it seems.
Yeah, and then it's so big and material. And every little room is, it has its like interior design. And, we'll see.
Can you say a few words about the fountain in the other room?
Should we go have a look?
I mean, this seems like the wave of the last wave. Like a shore, you know, a seashore or something. Or,
yeah. Mm-hmm.
Something's been inundated, like a wave. But then it seems also like it's some sort of corporate head office with a big logo on the wall.
Well, it's a franchise.
Okay.
So this is our own franchise. We've taken a few more liberties than corporate head office would normally allow, but in when we were filming Consider the Belvedere, there was a waves across the street, and that was kind of like the vantage point to film opening and closing shots of the film. So it kind of became this like, I don't know, this perspective on the Belvedere that we kind of wanted to add and as a new scene for the new film. I guess it also just,
it's a place to connect.
Yeah, that's their tagline. So,
and then we connected with them. We did really connect with Waves also with in making the floor, as we collected a lot of their waste from visiting various Waves locations and asking for the garbage. So we took the cups, and then we Vivian showed us how to dye with indigo. So we were making some fabric dye jobs, and then this massive paper dye, like almost like cauldron of glue in the cups and indigo. And then back there in the Belvedere, we have a little room looking out on Waves to just showing the process of the indigo, like the walls are lined with the sweetest pulp, like the most fine pulp of indigo and newspaper from this process here. And the color of this room is the color of the cup. So and the color of the hotel is an egg, and the color of the lab is a rock. So there's always this sort of incubation feeling in this exhibition, I feel like. And so you're in Waves, or they close now across from you. They did close down, so it's a bit of their afterlife. The afterlife that they're in. As my coffee's afterlife.
Mm-hmm.
And they're lit to sort of breathe, also like the waves. Flowing, ebbing and flowing, and we have this nighttime sign where it opens and closes. You can see it in the film with eyes open, eyes closed. And so this was a more like in-between state than that, but still it has the breath.
It's a nice sound to fall asleep to.
It does give the space a great sound. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Where are the CDs? We should have had them ready. You could have got one. Or just record this and have like. You can take home the wave, sound of waves. Yes. Yeah, what color of blue is it? Can you tell? It is indigo. Is it indigo? It's strange, It looks electric. Well, shall we
finish with the films?
Finish with the films, yeah.
Front row seat.
Yeah, it actually, to sit and watch the film, because it will be quite, 20, 15 minutes or something like that.
Yeah.
But feel free. And is it in order now? So the first one will be Bottles Under the Influence.
Yeah. Which is 8 minutes, and then the second is Consider the Belvedere, which is almost the same length. I don't know if we already kind of introduced them before, but anything else I want to say? The second film has music from composed by Johann Bjork. Otherwise, we basically shot and edited and soundtracked and
lit
and
set designed.
What else? Hair and makeup. We did it.
Styling.
ask us questions afterwards.
Yes.
And no credits.
The green twisted pair does have a poem.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Well, thank you.
Thank you.